Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Good afternoon. My name is Amy Draves, and I'm here to introduce and welcome Dr. Beth Coleman, who is joining us as part of the Microsoft Research Visiting Speaker Series. Beth is here today to discuss her book, Hello Avatar, Rise of the Network Generation. Real-time collaboration and co-presence is changing the way we make connections using networked media. A cultural shift has been happening, and most of us are living along the continuum between the real world and the virtual one. Somehow, we will show up digitally, and an avatar will continue to represent us out there. Dr. Coleman is a professor of writing and new media at MIT, and is faculty director of the C3 Game Culture and Mobile Media Initiative. She is currently a faculty fellow at Harvard Berkmeyer Center for Internet and Society and director of City as Platform Lab in Amsterdam. Last year, she was a consulting researcher at the Microsoft Research New England Lab. Please join me in welcoming her to Microsoft.
Hi, thank you. So I'm a little bit already predisposed to knowing that you guys are awesome, because I worked with your colleagues in Cambridge last year, and it was an incredible experience. And for me, to the best of my ability, I like very much kind of working between humanist kind of social science research and then applied practice around designing technologies. So the conversations that I've already been able to have here today with people working on avatars and people working on telepresence, they're quite awesome. Okay, so I started out this project around 2007 when Second Life was in all the media. Like, no virtual world has ever gotten as much press as Second Life did around 2007, which was the top of the hype cycle. It was as if this virtual space was going to give us everything we ever imagined. You can have a beautiful body, a great social life, you can have virtual money, you can have a mansion, all this stuff. And I just thought, how is it that people are getting so excited about this at this moment? Like, what happened? It's not the first virtual world. It's not the first online community. Yet there was this kind of tipping point of kind of euphoria around what it could represent. And then, of course, it all came crashing down. So I started looking at avatars and some of the experimental research around, well, what does it mean to design a good avatar? What's persuasive? What's comfortable? And then also looking at the simulated world. And what I walked out with a few years later was the strong sense that if what you're designing is for a virtual space, as if it's a walled garden, as if kind of what happens in a virtual world stays in a virtual world, or whatever cliche you want to put on it, then you're mistaken. Actually, what we should be designing for are porous spaces, spaces that take us to the virtual and whatever kind of engagements we have there, and then back again into whatever you call, you know, your so-called real life. So whether that's represented by going to work or going to the beach, but the located, the geographic, the kind of bodily present one. So I start to call this, instead of virtual reality and reality, just X-reality, because particularly because of mobile computing, because of the advent of mobile media in our pockets, our cell phones, we more and more are taking our company with us. We have, you know, Andre the Giant has a posse, we have a posse. In our pockets, we have our people with us in one form or another. So part of the investigation is SMS, what does it afford us? Skype, what does it afford us? A virtual world, what does it afford us? What are we getting from location and how are we getting it? Okay, so let me move on with it. So the way I've lined this up today is thinking about this as three design principles for networked media. And the first principle, it's not really a principle, it's the groundwork. So what I'm suggesting is we are already in a world that's increasingly visual, increasingly objectified in terms of you have a notion of something, you can see a picture of it. You get videos of things, you get 3D models of things, increasingly mobile, as I've discussed already, in fact, pervasively mobile, and then data-rich. And data-rich, whether it's you tracking yourself or you're in London and all the CCTV cameras tracking you, we are increasingly leaving a footprint about where we go. You see that online, and you see that also increasingly in the real world as you move around. So I'm talking about that as data rich. And the thing that I would like people to keep in mind as kind of the core of what I'm essentially advocating for here to think about with this next few years of where we're going with making new technologies is designing for agency, thinking about how can we make things so people can participate and they can feel comfortable, in control? I was talking to a friend last night and he said, you know, there's all these promises of new technology, yet we're afraid to look at our inbox. There's a way in which we're inundated, there's not enough filtering, there are these kinds of practical problems, but also thinking about as we go through the world, if I've got this thing in my hand, what more can I do with it? And what I'm aspiring to is help with some design around culture leading and not just commerce. I know where I can buy a cup of coffee, I know where I can catch a train, but what other things can I know about my environment that are engaging and, I mean, in my aspirational world, poetic? Okay, so summing this up, I'm thinking about everything is animated. So pervasive media, sensible objects, this whole thing of the world and Internet of Things, RFID, all the rest of it, where we have our rooms, our objects becoming increasingly animated with information. They tell us about who's here, they tell us about what can happen, they tell us about what they are. And there's a way in which we have to be very mindful of not creating dumb subjects. The world is getting smarter, but are we in fact getting dumber? And I've got a couple of different examples of kind of the world of dumb subjects, but just to give you a couple of just pictures of the data world, data visualization, Carlo Rotti, Sensible Cities. Here's a Madonna concert. Here's the World Cup in Rome. Yay. We see this this moment in time of everybody getting on their phones. SMS, yay, we won. Oh, she played like a virgin. So increasingly, we're able to map our spaces to understand kind of motion. I'd like to see not just the bird's eye view of the data of what we do, but design for this next level of how we can do and what we can do in those spaces. So PatTube is an example of an Internet of Things design. It's from the Hawk Architecture Group in the UK. And what they've done is they've designed, any of you who've ever worked with a patch bay making music or something. This is essentially the same idea, but what you can patch together is any environment with another. So a wireless pollution sensor can be connected to an office, a house can be connected to a web page, a virtual world can be connected to a regional office. So in effect, this kind of Internet of Things design, it addresses what I'm calling X-reality, where you're crossing between boundaries, and what's valuable is the ability for action and the sense of it being actual as opposed to whether something is brick and mortar or virtual. So in all this space of animation, the thing that concerns me is the increasing sense of inertia, the increasingly dumb subject, and I want to bring that to all of you here because you're smart and you design smart things. And I just want to remind you about what the experience might be on the ground in terms of we have lots of tech, we've got lots of things, but the basic, the quality of people's lives, their sense of having some control over here's my mini inputs and here are my outputs and here's me moving through my world and I have a sense of it, I can create a kind of journey here for myself as opposed to wow, all this stuff is coming at me. So some of it is inflection, but some of it is kind of the practicality of design. And we've run through this scenario every time we get a kind of new shift in technologies, network medias, or whatever it is, we go through the same scenario of we're going to be rendered into copper tops. So you've got the Desert of the Real from the Wachowski brothers from The Matrix, which is based on Baudrillard's theory about hypermediation. You've got the Spectre of 1984, where we're tiny and Big Brother is always watching us. You've got even Disneyland, which is the idea that more and more of our lives are this kind of a pretend space. It's very hard to get a sense of a feeling of the real. One of the illustrations of this idea of people kind of getting lost in the mix of their own avatars comes from the Richard Linklater movie, A Scanner Darkly, that came out a few years ago. So I want to show you a clip from that because it's the lowest of the low. Like, it's Keanu Reeves playing a cop, and the cop is chasing himself. He doesn't know he's chasing himself because he's searching after these drug addicts, but of course, because it's Philip K. Dick, he is the guy who he's looking for, Total Recall. They all work that way. And very much the equation here is overload of media, it's the same as drug addiction. And because it's so much the everyday practice as opposed to kind of the fantastic, I feel like it's a helpful illustration about what we need to be mindful about. But it ends up just being...
It looks like not like a constantly shifting vague blur and nothing more, am I right? Let's hear it for the vague blur.
Should have done that with the other media also.
If you saw me on the street without the suit on, you'd probably say, there goes a total dope fiend. You'd feel aversion and walk away. I don't look like you. I can't afford to. My life depends on it.
I'm not going to tell you first what I do as an undercover officer engaged in tracking down dealers and the source of their illegal drugs in the streets of our cities and corridors of our schools here in Orange County. I'm going to tell you what I'm afraid of. What I fear night and day is that our children, your children and my children...
I have two little ones. Very little. But not too little to be addicted. Calculatedly addicted to substance D for profit by drug terrorists.
Okay, so the basic problem here is there's a panopticon in his head, he's under surveillance, he's a man with no faces, yet there's no ground truth. In the end, you don't know whether it's delusional that he's hearing these voices, you don't know if he's being controlled. In effect, he's just he's a lost being. And in thinking through this kind of media as drug addiction, we're overwhelmed, we don't know what to do with ourselves. What I kind of went to find a way to think through, well, what are we supposed to do, is this is the nerd version of theory. I went to Derrida's idea of the pharmacon from Plato. And essentially this idea is you have this poison, and you see this in homeopathic remedies all the time. The remedy here to media is more media. Unless something catastrophic is going to happen, we actually need to find ways to make these systems more lucid for ourselves, more lucid for our users, more lucid for engagement. So, and I also want to bring in Albert Bandura's idea of agency, where he talks about interactional causal structure. Because if you talk about things in a finite way or maybe a humble way, I need to be able to have a sense that I can impact the world that I'm living in. And if you take kind of a game design theory of this, could it be something as simple as, here's a tile game, here's yellow, here's white. I can see I have that much impact on my system, and then I can build confidence from there, I can build strength from there. So I'm really willing to say let's start at the very small space, and we've talked already today about one of the primary tenets about some of the entertainment design here is people having a sense of modifying for themselves. They can take a certain set of options, and they say, okay, I own this one, this is mine. So it's even on that small level, and I do think that that builds up to much greater levels of, well, I mean, not to be too crazy about it, but you look at Tahrir Square, you look at some of the ways in which people are occupying public spaces in the world, and it is individuals taking small steps and then moving toward collective actions. And I can happy to talk about kind of social media use and Egypt offline after this, because I am doing a research project on that, bringing together kind of some data around the social media use and then testimony from people. But let me stick to the avatars at the moment. So in thinking about avatars, I went back to the earliest usage, which is from Sanskrit, and essentially the avatar is the faces of a god. Here you have Vishnu and Brahma and Shiva, and what you get in these images are three faces at once, and what you get is it's showing a temporal dimension. Here's three different moments, but it's also illustrating the idea of the god descending to do some action. And the action has to be embodied in the body of a hero. And that kind of mythological figuration of what an avatar can be, what an avatar has been historically, I found very powerful. The idea that we somehow are descending into these forms, these other forms that can move around in different ways, so we can perform heroic actions. Here we have Vishnu in his dwarf avatar. So this is, you know, before the guilds, we already had the dwarf avatars as an ancient part of our histories. And I think that it's important to read kind of the avatar of descending into these other bodies to be able to work productively with the history of simulation that we share, because they are working together. And this is the Sensorama simulator from 1962. We have a long history of before computing, flight simulation, et cetera, et cetera. The military historically has always used simulation before engines and all the rest of it. So in thinking about designing these environments and then thinking about avatars as actors within that, we can go through a short history of actually, you know, computer-based avatars. So Habitat, 1985, was the first multi-user, co-present virtual world. Then you have something like The Palace from 1996. You have The Quest of the Avatar, which is also 1985, at the same time that Habitat came out, where people started to talk about, in the computer design industry, avatars as these figures that were moving around. Persona is also another term that's been used, but avatar is stuck. And then we move to things like Full Spectrum Warrior, and like the history is cascading. There are many, many different examples of the simulation that we use for, in this case, the U.S. Army using it for training and for recruitment, also merging with game space, with play space. Then it was released as open source, and people could just play with it. And then we get to Second Life, where you have avatars sharing an environment, and there's no pretense of a game world. It's just you kind of making up whatever configuration you want with it. And okay, and the last thing that I want to speak to in terms of specifically avatars, this is a chart from Jeremy Bailenson, some of his research on what's important in terms of the representation of human beings as avatars. And what he found essentially was that behavior trumps verisimilitude. It trumps what something looks like in terms of the possibility of an avatar behaving effectively in an environment. So he goes from mirror to shadow to puppet to remote control car, and this is the kind of sweet spot of where the game avatars would be. And this is an important thing to think about in terms of where we are with the limits of representation. And we talked already this morning about, well, is what James Cameron did with Avatar the movie, where you have a very controlled environment, but one that took a tremendous amount of time to be able to just develop the technology around that. Can any of that be translated into what we can do kind of on the fly in real time in a shared computing environment now? And right now the answer is no. So in thinking about where to hit with design, we need to start thinking really, where's gesture? We have certain things that we can do with image, but where's gesture? Okay, so this brings me to the next set of principles, which is real-time, co-presence, and X-reality. And We see real time all over the place. One of the examples I give in the book is Lawrence Lessig giving a reading in legal scholar Lawrence Lessig giving a reading from his book in Second Life. And what I found with that gathering was it worked much like a gathering in a local bookstore. So we were able to get rid of the problem of proximity. Some people were in China, some people were in New York, and everybody could get together to do something not very fantastic. It wasn't like fighting a monster. It was to hear a book reading in a virtual space. So that worked well enough. I mean, there are all kinds of problems with how this space works in other respects, but that worked well enough in terms of what we can do with real time. And in terms of co-presence, one of the things that we're seeing trending with Skype is people not just using it for kind of teleconferencing, which is essentially how it's designed, but people using it for what scholar Mimi Ito calls ambient co-presence, where, and it's often partners, lovers who do this. I have my window open in Oslo, you have your window open in Redmond, and we hear each other's day. So you have to be quite intimate with someone to want to hear their day, because obviously this is not eventful. It's literally the ambient sounds of I'm making coffee, I put on some music, I'm on a phone call. But just thinking about, well, here's a technology that's been repurposed so people are sharing space with each other. And that kind of hack, since it came directly from users, it wasn't an intentional thing in terms of the design, I find that particularly delightful because it's people finding all kinds of agency around something that's been built, and they're saying it's open enough that I can repurpose it in really good ways. So this is, again, a picture of what I'm calling X-reality, where there's a group of plants, they do CO2 offset, you've got a group of computers linked together, and using a patch bay, it's automated in terms of your computer shut off when they've used too much. The emission levels are too high, and you've got to wait for things to bottom out or fill back up again with oxygen. So this kind of feedback loop, which was, you know, the fantasy of cybernetics from many years ago, where we're now able to enact this stuff in a very easy way in daily life. So the project that I am personally putting kind of my time and effort into trying to think about, well, how can I make these design principles, like where can I enact this stuff, is Cydia's platform, because if indeed I am correct enough and other people are correct enough in seeing the space of innovation is moving outside of the desktop and into the streets, back into the world, how do we make that translation in a way that's engaging and graceful and full of good things to do? And the way that I'm thinking about that is a kind of API for the city. If indeed you already have an informational city that works well enough, you know how to catch a bus, you know where to find something, you can read a map, how do we design for a next level of engagement that's somehow beyond the informational city? And the way that I'm describing that is kind of transmedia storytelling, or telling stories across the city. And this can engage things that you've seen a little bit of already, which is augmented reality, kind of real-time play, where you get the Pac-Man around this plots. You have in the Dom plots these virtual characters that you can only see through your layer viewfinder. So that's already a level of building on the habit that we're developing over something like Foursquare, where you check in. But what happens after the check-in? Like, how do we build the next level kind of sentence structure, semantics over, I know how to check in, but after I'm the mayor of this coffee shop, there has to be another layer of engagement for me to care. And we see a plateau in that kind of, both with Scavenger and Foursquare, where all you do is check in. So to activate situational design even more so, this is a town in England where literally they've painted their energy use on the street, so taking kind of data visualization and bring it back down to ground level. This is the Jejun Institute, who ran a three-year game in San Francisco that was an alternate reality game played throughout the city. Some of it was web-based, but it was really asking players to explore their environment with a story of this cult built on top of familiar sites of the city. This is an avatar therapist from the Dexter alternate reality game that I participated in working on for Showtime. And she's the therapist for the serial killer. And then the serial killer, you learn clues about him, and you know she's his robotic therapist. And you find the clues online, and then you go back out into the city, and you find actual objects, and you get this mixture from, you know, the online to the off and so forth. In the season premiere, they embedded, sorry it's a little bit dark, but in the bottom left of the corner, they embed the logo of this serial killer into the actual Dexter episode. And this was just a little kind of goose for fans because they could see what we did, this fiction that we were participating in. It made a difference. It shows up somehow in the reality, the canon of this world. So the idea here is thinking about designing content in context, and it can be online, off, or this kind of X-reality, this mixed space, and thinking about the public and the civic and the poetic. So help facilitating design where the secret things that you love about a place and how you want to share them perhaps in a secret way, so a kind of graffiti but a virtual one, that you need to kind of get it, opt into the code system to be able to read, that's more and more part of what is findable in the urban spaces that we move through. So the beta of this is a project I did in Paris in 2009 called Geofilm, and we took three different sites and designed located media around them. So this is the stills from an animation in Hotel du Soleil, where what we did was we just shot the square, turned it in Rhino into a 3D space, and then animated this event of this landing and this explosion that was the beginning of this thriller called The Hunter that you would play through the city. Let's see if I can get the video to load. So this is the clip from Butchemont, and you can see how location is strongly highlighted in the teaser. Suggesting is we can have things like a Connect ballet. We can have people out on the street playing these things with these objects for greater levels of engagement, participation, and a sense of agency in these media environments that we are designing. And let's see. Yeah, and there's my list of nine principles, public, civic, and poetic. Those are mashed up. And I want to, do you have any questions or any thoughts that you'd like to add to this list?
I'm curious, a lot of these examples seem to be centered around entertainment and gaming and artistic expression, but like, what type of shift do you think has to occur before we see more widespread adoption in, you know, productivity apps, or, you know, before the knowledge worker will start using avatars, you know, in a virtual world to like communicate with and collaborate with other people?
I think that they're not unrelated. The examples that I'm giving are very strongly from ideas of creative expression and gaming and kind of art and technology. But I think that some of the habits around media use and how people are able to have a sense of finding each other and keeping a conversation frame together. So when you're working on the project, it's actually very, very hard to keep track of all the pieces unless everyone is literally in the same office or in the same lab. And it's a problem that many of us have been addressing in our research. And how do you figure out, well, how do you keep track? And then also, how can you design for efficiency here? So for example, I'm working with John Palfrey on digital library for the future. We've got all these archives, they're disparate, they're not coded, the metadata is all different, they're not all searchable, and also the way that the actual physical libraries are being used in relationship to online information, it could all just work better. So I get a call from the head of the libraries in Birmingham in the UK, and she's addressing exactly the same problem. How do you make it better usable for now? How can you create a proper digital archive? And I really think the first problem that we have to solve here is streamlining the different bits and pieces of research that all the different people have been doing, because it's clear that there's redundancy. And I can't guarantee that the best answer will be apparent once we see where the points of redundancy are, but at the very least, we have to figure out how do we bring these things together, because we see people working on the same stuff. And some of this game space and creative space and kind of design space for play, the idea is we practice for all the other parts of our lives. They're not so separate. So for example, this is a really trivial difference, but I was talking to Jim about this at lunch. It's relatively new for us that we can get our email on a kind of handheld device, which means you can be skiing or you can be at the gym or whatever. And it's not so much the design of being able to get your email, it's the habit around how do you know when to check? How do you know when to turn off? So how can you be a better colleague and coworker? Because being a better colleague is not checking your mail all the time and just being stressed. It's checking it in the right rhythm for the project. So you know when the Beijing people are kind of awake. You know when the Stockholm people are kind of awake. So it's something about a culture around the technologies and not only the design of it. So what I aspire to is this having value in spaces that are not just about entertainment, even though I think entertainment's a pretty valuable space. But go ahead.
Are there any studies or research saying that this is like what, that this sort of interaction would be what people want? Because going back to, let's say, the co-presence, and I think the term you used was like intimate co-presence, was that it? Yeah. In my mind, I was just thinking, well, that sounds like being on Skype and vicariously living through someone else. And I could see some people that might want that, but some of the wider ideas, like cities as a platform and everything, they seem to require a lot of prerequisites in order to even have that. And when thinking about this globally, I mean, there are a lot of countries out there, or areas which, you know, are far, far away from having any of the prerequisites to be able to have anything like this. And so, going back to like saying, is this what people really want? Are there any researchers? Is there any research saying that like this is really, you know, a viable thing in terms of the way that humans want to communicate with their surroundings?
Well, Facebook is the size of a small nation. I mean,
yeah, I'm surprised you didn't mention that.
The fact that people can and do want to share trivial information, important information at that level, in some ways that's already established in terms of the wave of social media. Much of social media was not about innovation in technology, it was about innovation in behavior. And the reason that I think it's actually a rich time to work on a city as a platform is because we have a couple different things coming online at once. Increasingly, we've got smarter cities. So the sensor networks that we need to be able to understand kind of the data city, those are increasingly available. The city of Amsterdam, who I've been working with, I've sat down with engineers and computer scientists and the kind of city bureaucrats, and what they have are huge databases of this is how people use our city. We know this about the patterns, and the question we have is, can we use this in any way that we can continue to try to design efficiency? We know we need more trams at this hour because there's always a traffic jam, but in some ways, that's a problem solved. The problems that they haven't solved are, how do you help facilitate people in neighborhoods who live next to each other for 15 years, but they never talk to each other? How can you facilitate a kind of cultural engagement? And there's not a promise that designing stories around a city and finding kind of like a big story here is the 400-year anniversary of the building of the dams, which is such an iconic part of the city, but there's an opportunity. There's really an opportunity. And because people all over the world are engaging with mobile devices, and you can say, yes, it's at different levels. But for example, in Nairobi, they don't have smartphones in the same kind of penetration as they do in Seattle. But my understanding is they're about to have smartphones for about $50 or $60 a handset. So if I talk to Juliana Rocic from Ushahidi, who's designing kind of crisis mapping around upheaval, her question is, we've really successfully designed crisis mapping for upheaval, but how do we work toward designing technologies for sustaining? So that's community building as opposed to just triage. So these are some of the... And we also see a lot of industry engagement in terms of talking about making the city smarter, but we don't yet see, in my view, enough engagement about helping make the people smarter, helping the people feel more engaged in these environments that are increasingly smart. So those are some of the reasons that I feel like this is an incredible opportunity, because it doesn't yet exist. And we have all the pieces, we just haven't really lined them up to say, well, what can we do here? And we also are seeing a plateauing in online gaming and these other spaces that had had major growth in terms of network communities, engagements over the past few years. So it's time for kind of another moment. Go ahead.
I was wondering, have you seen much focus or interest in giving individuals, you talk about agency, control over their digital footprint, and they leave breadcrumbs behind. Right now, when people are on Facebook, they're actually creating value for some other corporation.
Yeah.
And I see that personally in the people I know causing pullback from participation.
That's
and
right.
Perhaps a desire for a more public electronic commons or forum to participate in, as
That's
opposed
right.
to playing in corporate entities where you're being exploited or used by a corporation.
Yeah, I mean, I think that it's hard not to use Google or the equivalent, even though what we do is we just add to their database. We have a problem in terms of what's popular. Like, most of us use YouTube, even though there are, had been alternative models where people who are putting up content could get paid a percentage, but those failed. And you'd think, well, that's a smarter thing. Why not help people get paid for their content? Yet YouTube, which has a very different model, is the one that, that dominates with users. So I agree with you that that's, in terms of agency and also kind of politics, that would be a great thing to see happen. What we have to look at is where can it happen and how can it be kind of easily done and put in people's hands, and who's going to do it. For Facebook to lead on this would be incredibly valuable, and it's some of what I personally have advocated with them, but we need to see a shift there. We need to see more demand for it. And at this moment in time, people are increasingly kind of monitoring their data systems of a combination of things, how far they run, what they read, how fast they read, all this kind of stuff. But the value of kind of having ownership of our data profile, it's not clear enough to people why that would be valuable. So there's kind of education right there as well.
Yeah, sort of like rights management technology we have where you can eliminate the conversation.
Right, and I mean, isn't it similar to, well, what's the status of the internet in terms of net neutrality and the rest? People don't even know why they might need to advocate for one thing or another. Go ahead.
Hi, I wanted to introduce a notion I'm thinking about as we're going through this, and it's the whole notion that what's made social media successful to this point, whether it be Twitter or Facebook or what have you, is kind of the Western notion of we're a little narcissistic. We like to embellish ourselves, and if you notice, it's all about us. What you're advocating, which is very interesting and refreshing, is a more mature social media, where you're doing this for a much more elevated, it seems, social purpose, where it's kind of like social media grows up and looks beyond themselves and says, it's not about me, it's about my community, and you start to extend that. Is that a proper framework, or I'm misreading it, or what is your...
I think that people use the same social media tools to be narcissistic as they did to create regime change in Tunisia. So some of it is context, content and context. Facebook worked very well for strategic organizing around, we're going to rally at this point in Egypt at Tahrir Square and SMS. I mean, the question I'm asking is, if you have a certain engagement with your local community, the people who matter to you most, when you get a kind of co-present moment, does it enable you to make one decision or another decision? Yeah, it seems, I didn't realize that that's what I was advocating, but that seems, for me, that's a worthy engagement to think about. Well, what if social media grows up? My sense of it is we've reached a certain limit in terms of, I like Foursquare, but I think that it's super limited. And you can see this in the user numbers. It spiked really quickly, and then it plateaus, and then it falls off. And it falls off because you can only check in so many times. And after that, there has to be something to do. And in my view, if we're kind of bringing on kind of like channeling Vishnu and becoming heroes, why not? Go ahead.
Just to add on to that, I mean, that sounds interesting to call it the growth of social media, but I think that where we're at right now is more of, you know, a democratization or, you know, a descent with power of, you know, the reason why people can be so narcissistic is because they're in control of their data. They can do what they want. Going to the model, which is the complete opposite of having someone else control your data and having someone else tell you X, Y, and Z, even if it is beneficial, I'm not sure if in the, you know, between where we are now and that is called a growth, or is it just a cycle in terms of where the power lies in terms of who controls what and who who is pushing what agenda. Because, I mean, even though this, like, some of the ideas are really good, of being able to basically utilize almost like crowdsourcing, you know, information in order for the greater good. But in the end, like, who's controlling it? If it's a city, then it's going to be, you know, whatever department in the city is, you know, controlling that. In the end, it seems like it just comes down to who controls the data and, you know, who's pushing what agenda, whether I'm an individual pushing my narcissistic agenda or if I'm, you know, in some city and I'm, you know, the mayor there and I want to push a certain agenda.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think that the moment that I'm looking at is one of the groups that I'm working with, the current city foundation, they have all of this information about the city of Amsterdam, and they're saying, well, what can we do with it? And there's always going to be a bias. There's always going to be some control factor, but the basic design challenge I see here is, can we take some of this information and make it human readable? Can we make it human facing in a way that's productive for people? And to say productive, there's already a bias in terms of, well, what do I think is productive? What do you think is productive? But, I mean, we design things every day. That's just part of it. But that's the moment that I'm seeing. We have this information. How can we engage it beyond bus routes and stopping traffic jams, which are all worthy, but there's more to be done here, I think. Go ahead.
One of the things that I see really present in the inflection point that we're at right now is about a generational shift. And I go back to what Niels Bohr said. He said, don't take radical new ideas, tell everybody and have them accept it. And you tell the young and you feel old to die. And so I spent a lot of time, about every month or so, I take my older daughters aside and I query them on what they've been doing recently, you know, to find out that they're doing things that I wouldn't have expected with avatars, with social media. You know, for example, the middle daughter was playing hide-and-go-seek in World of Warcraft with her friends. She wasn't battling monsters. They were playing hide-and-go-seek because they could do it.
Right.
The older one, I asked her, if your employer in the future asks you to see your Facebook page when you open it up to him or her, and she said, yeah. And the only reason that she's locked down or until this thing was locked down was because I told her she had to be. But her view was, what the hell? People know who I am. And I see the comments sometimes in meetings like this about, well, this is what the expectations are, and this is what the expectations are. It's from old people. It's not from the young generation. They don't care. They don't have the same set of values. And I think the generational shift will occur more because they see things very, very fundamentally differently. And another question related was, not only generational, but cultural. Some of the statements you've made applies to a Western society, but the way I look, I spent a lot of time in Asia and lived in Japan for a while. I don't see they map that way either, in the same way you've described them. So how much of what you've looked into draws a distinction between what's generally a Western view and therefore applies to this problem set, and what would be?
No, that's very good. People have asked me that before, and I've got a first design site for Amsterdam, but this is about platform and designing flexible tools. And for it to work, it needs to be able to translate itself to different environments. So I mean, we have a very strong game culture in Asia, but it doesn't mean that it maps to the kind of gaming that I'm describing. Certainly there's interest in, specifically Nairobi is the city where I know people and have started to talk about this project, because they said, we want to think about the poetic, we want to think about the sustainable, we want to talk about kind of community tools and not just crisis. So I can't extrapolate. I agree with you that my framing, it comes from a Western perspective, and it will first be kind of addressed to a Western city. But Amsterdam is carefully chosen because it's also a very important kind of global city with like a 400-year history of different kinds of people coming through, and also what its population looks like now. So as opposed to someplace like New York or someplace, I mean, San Francisco or LA might be more interesting along those lines also. But in trying to think about what's a good test zone? Because you have the Moroccan youth of Amsterdam, you have the older traditional Dutch communities of Amsterdam, you have these kind of traveler crews coming through. Like, you have a mixed population that represents kind of the future of what global cities will look like. And, you know, Shanghai is not monoculture either. So there's ways in which we're trying to practice in one local some things about trying to think globally. And what does it mean to try to design globally if culture is part of what you're doing? It's not just handing somebody a computer and saying, okay, turn it on. I mean, maybe some of that is cultural too, but I think that's helpful what you've said.
I'll close the questions there. Thank you so much for joining us.
Yeah, you're welcome.